Hare Krishna, thank you for joining once again.
Hare Krishna, welcome.
So today we will probably be completing the last part of our social justice discussion. In the first part, we discussed about the principles of social justice and how communism, socialism, and these different thought systems were addressing that. In the second part, we talked about the caste system in India and whether it was meant for social justice. So we talked about how the caste system is often said to bring about division, but it also brings inclusion. It also gives a sense of belonging. It also helps people to have a place when they don't have particular talents to compete in particular areas, they get a place in society. So then today we'll discuss about how the Varnashram went wrong and how in today's Indian context, the purpose of social justice can be served through spiritual wisdom. So would you like to talk about what went wrong over the centuries or millennia in terms of the caste system?
I read an interesting saying, some say it is Chinese or it could be other cultures also, that a fish rots from the head.
Yes.
And if the intellectuals were considered the leaders of the caste system, so we have intellectuals, we have administrators, we have mercantilists, and then we have the tertiary sector, the service sector. So that false pride of on part of the intellectuals. And there is an interesting incident mentioned in Srimad Bhagavatam where a young boy, and basically this young boy is chosen because he's described as immature, and he sees that a great king, Maharaj Parikshit, insulted his father for apparently no reason. The father was in trance. The king came and said, I'm fatigued, I'm hungry, I'm thirsty, I need some water. It seems like the sage did not respond. So in anger, the king draped a dead snake. He hung it around the neck of the sadhu and he left. And people came and told this young boy that this great king, so-called great king, insulted your father. Without thinking at all, this powerful brahmana was a boy. He just took some water in his hand and said, I curse that he dies within a week. So this anger on part of the brahmanas, the priests, the intellectuals, in trying to pull down the warriors or the administrators of the kings is accepted as the beginning of the end, where instead of pious, honest, simple living and austere intellectuals who guide chivalrous administrators, who protect productive, tax-paying and loyal mercantilists, and they protect the service sector. What we have today is a rebellious service sector, which is very, very bent upon only understanding its own interests. There is a large mercantile class. Like they're saying that Jeff Bezos could become the first trillionaire in the world. Now imagine the kind of power and clout this person could have. They are wary or afraid of exploiting administrators, and practically the austere, simple intellectuals are not there. Even if they are there, they take recourse to asserting their right that because I am born in a particular family, I have to be considered as such. And actually, Prabhupada famously would say, the son of a high court judge cannot just sit on the bench saying that my father was a high court judge, so I can sit here. Or a son of a surgeon cannot start performing surgery just because he's the son of a... So the theory by birth, your vocation or your entire life is practically laid out. That went wrong in a very bad way.
So this could be said to be a result of an entitlement mentality also. Isn't it that if I'm born in a particular family, I'm entitled to the rights of that family, rights of whatever is there in the family. And it's significant that not only does Krishna say in the Bhagavad Gita, this was guna karma vibhaga shaha, as according to qualities and activities, but even when later he describes about the Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudras, he described them in terms of guna karma only. These are the qualities of the, these are the kind of works that they do. So when this kind of rigid stratification or what is ossification started happening, that in some ways previously the caste barriers were there, but they were more permeable, but they became impermeable. And then there was, it's been going on for centuries actually, when in some ways Buddhism and Jainism, they gained popularity because they preached in the local languages, the vernaculars, and they attracted followers from the lower castes to some extent. But things came to a boil. It seems that with the egalitarian ideas coming from the West, that the lower castes are being discriminated against. That awareness, oh, this has to be avoided. You know, it's, there is not, if you look at the, you know, Buddhism or Jainism, many Buddhists or Jain thinkers, they critiqued Hinduism. But the caste system is not prominent in their criticism of Hinduism. It is, even Islam, when it is criticized, when it tried to win converts, it was mostly by force. So the point I'm making over here is, even when the system degraded, whether the discrimination was as unconscionable as is sometimes portrayed in the media, now that is open to question. Because some amount of distance was there in the past. Almost all societies were highly hierarchical. And say in Britain also, the butler and the village and the staff, they would eat at their own place. And aristocracy would eat in a different place. This is not to defend the discrimination that was there, and some of it was terrible. But the point is that sometimes it's the magnitude that is portrayed may well be far more than what it actually was. So even when the system got corrupted, so the Brahmana started becoming maybe position more power hungry or position hungry, but still, was it that the lower castes were incessantly persecuted so much so that they couldn't even live? No, they have survived, and the numbers are still significant. So again, this is not to justify, but simply to contextualize that sometimes when one evil is pointed out, that evil can be exaggerated disproportionately.
Yeah.
Any thoughts on this?
Exactly. Now we have just to give persecution of the power of the powerless by the powerful. If I try to strip away all the halo about caste and caste system, we have the native Indians being kind of exterminated. And there's a general plan for that in America. We have the Aboriginal population in Australia. Just now they have a day where they say sorry. But when somebody said, okay, you took the land, but would you care to compensate? So the current politician said, we are very clear, there's not going to be any kind of compensation. We are just saying sorry. So this seems to be a human frailty, that anytime somebody becomes powerful, rather than caring about the powerless, there is a tendency towards exploitation. And as you rightly said, Britain could not conquer Indian mentality by acknowledging that your temple culture, your spiritual wisdom is way ahead of anything that we have seen. That would not have worked at all. So systematically, they had to educate the population that this is the worst kind of social system we have ever seen, that somebody cannot enter the temple, somebody cannot do this, somebody cannot do that. So to give it proper, to give the proper points, Christianity never had someone not entering a church. But over the last 2000 years, we have seen huge, large scale violence on Catholics or on Protestants, depending upon a particular decade or whatever situation it could be. Similarly, Shia Sunni violence continued. So in almost all social aspects of life everywhere in the world, let me give you a simple example from the Indian point of view. I don't think any average Indian can see the difference between a Japanese, Chinese or a Korean person. They all look the same.
Okay, yeah.
But if you say historically, the Japanese really scorned the Chinese so much. They consider them filthy, not even fit to live. Similarly with the Koreans. So although from...
So the Koreans scorn Chinese or the Japanese scorn Chinese?
The Japanese scorn Chinese. The Japanese scorn Koreans also.
Oh, okay.
So till today, Japan is not willing to admit its war crimes. You know, although Germany kind of said, yes, we made that mistake. But Japan has not yet done that. And that
I think there's that famous book called Rape of Nanking. There's an author who wrote that book and then she committed suicide.
So you're right when you say that that kind of an organized pogrom, that means they organize huge scale killing, extermination, we just don't want them. The wrong attitude was, you don't come close and stay with us. You don't do anything beyond what you are supposed to do. Like the favorite case of scholars, either from West or from India, is to see that scavengers, they clear away human feces. And if they ask them that, why are you doing that? So that's our job. So if you ask somebody, why are you packing things in the Amazon, go down. So that's my job. But if you start saying that my father also was in an Amazon warehouse, his father also was in an Amazon warehouse, and I don't have any other choice, but my son also has to be in an Amazon warehouse. They say, oh, that is injustice. So this is where, to be fair, we have to agree that this kind of thing was. So somebody with good qualifications still has to do scavenging, and somebody born in a high family with no qualification still has the right to perform pujas or get donation or whatever. And this is where the rot kind of settled. And so that is what went wrong. You have any other points, or you want to go on to the next point of how to find the way ahead?
Yeah, just I think that will relate to this only. A quick point about this, that often America, as contrasted with Britain, prided itself on its egalitarianism. That in Britain there was so much condescension or hierarchy, but they said we are equal. But their equality did not really go up to the African Americans or even to the Native Americans. So in a sense, there is always some kind of filters people have based on whatever be the context. So
One point. A historical point that Britain abolished slavery many, many decades before even America thought about it.
That's so amazing. And it was for moral reasons or political or what?
Pure commercial reasons, like Thomas Jefferson, when he says that we believe it to be a self-evident truth that all men are created equal and they have the right for liberty, happiness, pursuit of happiness. he was not at all thinking about the slaves he had. He was owning. He also had slaves.
That means,
although he could be a benign owner and he was not known to be cruel or whatever, but it didn't occur to him that they should be also, when they say all men. So again, not to find a fault or to put find a point, but this is how people, being product of their own times, they think. And the cotton growing area was in the west, the south of America. The north and east and west part of America, the trading ports and other things. So obviously the south was thinking that we need this labor, and what better way than to keep them as slaves? So thus began the whole discussion from a purely commercial point of view, till of course Abraham Lincoln kind of took the helm and he decided that better we not have it. And there is a book, Uncle Tom's Cabin. Have you gone through that anytime?
I've heard about it. What is
that? So that is a book about a slave written by one lady, and that sparked off the idea that we should be finishing slavery once and for all.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so now one point about social justice, which is critiqued, which is a criticism for India or the caste system, is that while every country has had its discrimination, but in India, this discrimination was religiously rationalized. That those who are in the lower castes, they were told that it is because of your past bad karma that you are born there.
Mm.
And because that's where you are meant to stay. So some people say that because of the philosophy of karma and reincarnation, Hinduism doesn't have much of an instinct for social justice, that everybody is just suffering their karma. But in contrast, often this is an accusation primarily leveled by Christians. They say that Jesus showed compassion to the poor, and that humanitarian work and welfare is what is very central to Jesus' mission and message and mission. So social justice, how much? So now the caste system is at one level, it is a evil which is there, and slowly it is disappearing. And there are various attempts being done for trying to rectify it. There is, in America, there was affirmative action. In India, there was reservations. But these are more political measures. But are there, so there are two parts of this discussion, that when you have to set things right, so is social justice or a rationale for social justice absent because of the Vedic philosophy? And conversely, now if within the Indian society social justice is to be established, are there resources spiritual resources available within the tradition that can inspire social justice to take place?
This is what we are exploring now.
Yeah, there's two things. So, was social injustice? Yeah, you would like to start. Was social justice perpetrated because of the philosophy of karma and reincarnation? You have any thoughts on this, or should I start and then you can?
You start. I'll add something later.
So my understanding of this is two parts, that there is at one level, life is discriminatory. Some people are born wealthy, some people are born poor, some people are born healthy, some people are born sick. So we all need some kind of mental framework to be able to accept where we are. And among the various thought systems that the world has come up with, the rationale of karma and reincarnation is the most logical, or you could put it the least illogical.
Okay.
To say, So to say that God is arbitrary and God has ordained that somebody be born poor and somebody be born wealthy, that really makes God indiscriminatory. So you see, there are only three alternatives, broadly speaking. Either God has ordained it, or it is by chance, or it is by our own past actions. So as far as accepting one situation in life, karma and reincarnation are empowering. If somebody is born in a deprived position, why is it like this? So it empowers. Now, of course, if somebody else starts holding it against them forever, you were born here, that means you are, say, sinful. But I don't know whether that was either the intent or that was the application, because charity is also a very important attribute. And while at one level it is said charity should be given to the Brahmanas, but then at another level charity was given to everyone. So it's Brahmanas because they meant to guide the society, and in a sense they are important. But apart from that, it was, if we consider Lord Macaulay, when he had come to India, he said, I've toured across India and I haven't seen a single beggar anywhere in the country. And this was just maybe about 200 years ago or something like that. And when the British came to India, the GDP of India, the GDP or whatever term you want to use, the economy of India, the economic share of India in the world was the largest. It was equivalent to all of Europe. And Europe was at the time of almost colonizing and rising. So generally, if there is a lot of disparity in wealth, there are some people who are horribly poor and some people are infuriatingly wealthy, then people can't tolerate it for very long and they rebel against it. So the fact that there was the caste system in India, and yet the three facts are there. The caste system was there. Second was India was prosperous. And third is that there's not much of a revolution in India, like say the French Revolution against the queen. Queen was told that peasants don't have bread, and they should eat cake then. And they got so angry that they burned up, they destroyed the Bastille and everything. So there's no kind of revolution happened. That means that even if the lower caste people were there, they were reasonably taken care of. So whether that actually, so my understanding, karma and reincarnation was meant to help people accept where they are at. But was it to justify injustice, to justify discrimination? No, there is a very important ethos of charity which was there. And the charity was given. Even now we see in the temples, charity is given, food is given. In many, many temples they offer food. So I feel that's a unwarranted extrapolation or misapplication of the philosophy. Any thoughts?
It was more like a device used to tell Indian population that it is we who have come to give you better protection, a better identity, and a better social system. And kind of all of India's population practically accepted it hook, line, sinker, that yes, they have come to civilize us. Although now that discoveries are being made that India's prosperity was such and such, and there was so much of treasury here, and people were trading in spices and precious stones and silk and everything. This was more like an ideological warfare which they won. They had to accept it.
Okay. Yeah, so that means, so instead of using the word social justice, we could say use charity and compassion were a part of the culture itself. And even people who were deprived were taken care of. So now, in today's India, how much is caste a defining reality, and what can the spiritual wisdom offer to rectify social injustice as it remains? Any thoughts on this, or should I start again?
I just read that this last point, that it was India's rapid industrialization which made caste practically impossible. Maintaining the system became impossible. That you cannot ask the person sitting next to you in a bus, public bus or a metro or anywhere in cinema theater. You cannot ask in an office, you cannot ask someone who's same pay scale like you to ask what caste you are from. It has remained, however, alive in marriages, and where it is, still there are small, infrequent incidents of people from high caste marrying people from lower caste, but the industrialization somehow just physically made it impossible, at least in the cities and metros. It is somehow surviving in the villages. That also is true. There is not much of a, I'm just making a segue into the solution part. Apart from the bhakti tradition, we don't have many who have given a reasonably good answer as to how this problem can be dealt with, not just dealt with in a physical sort of way, like reservation. Say, okay, just make so many professorships only for people from this particular strata. But then you find that sometimes the education system suffers because of that.
That's true. You know, when you mentioned about industrialization, when you said industrialization has made castes unsustainable, that's true. But in the urban place cities or urban places, if at all caste remains, it remains in the government sector, because there in the hiring of people, there is reservation. In the private sector, there is nothing like that. So, in a sense, as India has become more like a free market economy, then that is receding into the consciousness away, receding away from the mainstream consciousness. Yeah, you can go ahead.
Yeah, so therefore, just making a segue into the solution part, the thought process contributed by the bhakti saints, bhakti tradition, kind of gives the most valid an authentic response to the situation today. We can also see that many, if not most, of the main acharyas, they were actually born as very high class brahmanas.
As high class?
We do have, yeah.
Okay.
Upper class. At the same time, we also have equally powerful devotees who appeared in so-called lower castes.
Okay, interesting. Now we could differentiate between acharyas and saints. So it seems those who established the lineages of bhakti, they were born in the upper castes, but there are many saints who are respected in the tradition, but they were born maybe in the lower castes.
Perhaps one could not have any more of a certification of this attitude. If you go to Udupi temple, you find the Sri Vigraha, Murti of Udupi Krishna. He has turned his face away from the main door and is looking towards a small window which bears the name of Kanaka Das.
Yes, beautiful. I think there are stories of Jagannath also like that.
So many stories. Yeah. So Krishna on his part, as when he says that, you know, I am the tasya kartaram api avayam, I have created this system, but I don't belong to it. Hmm. And certainly in his own way, and by inspiring great acharyas, he has already made the wisdom available. I would put it like that. To show the way ahead, the wisdom is available, the know-how is available.
So how exactly does the bhakti tradition invert the or correct the hierarchical injustice? One is simply by spiritualizing the consciousness, So one is, of course, if you talk about, say, God or Krishna himself intervenes and he shows that his love doesn't discriminate between higher and lower castes. So that is one way. Another way we could also say is that bhakti tradition talks about, goes beyond the body to the soul, to the heart. And the heart, so the heart is where one's character is there, the core of who one is there. And that is what is valued. So in that sense, any discrimination caused by external, such as the body, they are transcended because what is considered to be of value is different. So in the caste system, or at least the caste system that became deviated, the body was considered of value or defining. But within the bhakti tradition, there is not the body, but it is the heart and the virtues of the heart and the devotion of the heart that is considered of value. So basically, it's to correct social injustice, we could have some amount of socio-political measures, but ultimately, it has to be a change of value system. Because we can never really have a flat socio-economic division where everybody will have the same amount of wealth. Communism tried that and it just had it was a disastrous failure. So there will always be some people who will be wealthier, some people who will be poorer. So, but if the spiritual wisdom or spiritual tradition can provide one resources by which this division between the wealthy and the poor, it is internally balanced so that the wealthy don't inordinately exploit the poor, but the wealthy give charity to the poor and the wealthy are compassionate. Then, so does bhakti itself, at one level, the saints themselves, it's true that they were considered exalted. But does bhakti itself in any special way provide some insights or impetus for correcting social wrongs?
In many ways, if we can just enumerate a few, first of all, it improves your worldview that like environmental exploitation, first of all, begins with your own body, which is your first microcosm of an environment. And you are taught not to exploit even your own body, what to speak of others' bodies, what to speak of the collective body of society, what to speak of the entire physical planet where we stay. So this is a very lofty worldview, but there it is. So once that exploitative mentality is eradicated and one becomes sort of a cooperator, so then Krishna promises the Bhagavad Gita that anena prasavishyadhyam esa vas vishtakamatuk, that even the agents who are controlling the elements of the environment, seeing your non-exploitationary nature, will gladly provide you everything what you need. So once you feel that there is no need for me to exploit from someone, because I have plenty. I may have plenty of wealth, I may have plenty of wisdom. Secondly, bhakti teaches you that you are a custodian of whatever you have. Even if you have taken a high birth, it is you are a custodian of that. So taking out the sting, as they say, a narrow-minded view that this life is all in all that I have, then you have to exploit, because it's like party time. Eat, drink and be merry, for tomorrow we die. But bhakti says there is no just don't take it out as a goal of life, but eat, drink and we may not be merry and we die and then we get born again. So that, as you rightly said, you take out an exploitatory thing, it takes away the idea that I need to exploit someone else. The last thing I would say is bhakti tradition, the wisdom especially, that I am eternally a servitor of Godhead. And everybody also is. So who is the person who says that your service has been accepted and I am happy with it? It is Krishna, God. So when a Brahmana serves, he may or may not get that certificate. But a a Shudra, a cobbler, a shoemaker, as we see in the story of Narad Muni, he very nicely pointed out that somebody immersed in rituals doesn't have that cutting edge faith which is so much required. And somebody not having anything to do with rituals or with reading tomes of religious books, but in his heart, he has faith. And Narad Muni kind of tests that, whether it is blind faith, oh, God is good, God is all good. No, it is rational faith. So, I'm not going to go into that story so much, but the idea is that bhakti gives you that sense of being a servitor. So, if everybody is a servitor, that is equality.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody is a servitor. Nobody is a controller. Nobody is an exploiter. Nobody is an enjoyer. Nobody is a proprietor.
So I think this is
This is what everybody hints at, all the social justice reformers, but they are missing the central point as to who can be the person who enjoys the results of all these various castes and communities. That no thinker apart from the bhakti text has come up with that kind of a solution. You want to add something? You have an objection?
Yeah, no. So one thing, when we talk about these resources, they're very, very important. Is this something distinctive to the bhakti tradition, or would this be something which would be offered by any theistic tradition?
Now you rightly put it, it seems like any tradition which has the core concepts of like three things, there is a servitor, there is service, and there is a person who accepts a service. So bhakti, bhagwan, bhakti, bhakta, bhakti, bhagwan. Wherever you find this, you can safely assume that this society is progressive. This society can keep things, as they say, right side up.
Yes. Now, just to take this further, if somebody could argue that social justice is inhibited by the philosophy of karma and reincarnation, but we could turn that argument around, and there is a saying that actually in this life, if you are in a state of prosperity, that means you are exhausting your past good karma. And if you are in a state of adversity, that means you are exhausting your past bad karma. So if we consider it that way, then even if somebody is at the top in the hierarchy, somebody wealthy, somebody is powerful, then if they understand that actually I am depleting my past karma just by being in this past good karma, being in this good position. So it's important for me to do some good karma. And one good karma would be giving charity. So in that sense, the philosophy of karma, if it is understood properly, it can actually give an impetus for giving charity. So, rather than considering prosperity to be just something that I have earned by my hard work, yes, people do have to work hard to become prosperous or powerful. But apart from that, if we understand the principle of karma and reincarnation, it actually won't lead to such an entitlement mentality at all. Because I have it now, it's because of my past, and I have to earn good karma for doing something in the future. So the philosophy, so in this sense, the Vedic tradition can give an additional impetus for compassion and social justice. That I can't let my bad karma get exhausted, good karma get exhausted, and I also need to earn some good karma. And in that sense, it is said that while giving charity also, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita in the 17th chapter that while giving charity, it should not be given disrespectfully. Because in a sense, the person to whom I'm giving charity, at a practical level, I am doing favor to that person. But from a karmic perspective, by accepting my charity, that person is doing a favor to me. So that person is enabling me to earn some good karma. So I think avagyatam. Krishna says that if charity is given disrespectfully, that is considered charity in the mode of ignorance.
Yeah.
So, or even if charity is given resentfully, that is in the passion, and Krishna says that is all also not recommended.
Even if it is done with the result of getting something more in the future, that also is not highly encouraged. Only if it is done as a duty towards the cosmos, duty towards my understanding of bhakti, only that is considered a qualifying kind of act of charity.
Okay. So, yattu pratyupkarartham phalamuddishya vapuna. Yeah. So, now that means that is considered goodness. So, even passion itself is offering some impetus actually. And if you're doing it for some returns, that also is an impetus. What to speak of if there is an understanding of goodness and enlightenment that is to be achieved by doing one's duty properly. So this could be a powerful resource. Now, now we have a bhakti tradition alive even now. Active, ISKCON is there, there are other movements also. Have any of these traditions actively engaged in social justice? I know there are some Madhva Sampradaya teachers who actually went and met with the lower caste people and ate among them, and they tried to create some unity. There are some Shankaracharyas also who did that. So overall, now in principle, we understand there are resources, but in practice, is there something which has been done, and is there something that individually as practitioners of bhakti we can do to further social justice?
Well, in one sense, that if we take the practice of sadhana bhakti as Prabhupada gave, giving the mantra, giving initiation, giving service, whether in a temple or at a farm, whether in a Govinda restaurant or even in research, absolutely no credence or no mention was made about the social background of a person. A candidate for initiation simply was somebody interested in elevating himself or herself. So that itself is a statement. Now, this is not exactly the caste system, but during the apartheid times, when South Africa was actively promoting apartheid, basically meant, it's a nice word, it means separate development or separate arrangement. But it was much more crueler than what was shown to the world. So, Bhakti Tirtha Swami, born in an African-American family, he, although being black, he was an intellectual. He was a first Princeton graduate. And he told one Professor Oliver in South Africa that I think Mr. Dr. Oliver had come to Nairobi, and he said that in this temple, we have a pujari who's from Kenya, a gardener from New Zealand, and the temple president is a local Indian or whatever. And he was amazed. He said, how do you manage that? Because that time it was, now it is separate, but different time. But so he said that, well, it all depends upon your worldview. It all depends upon what kind of guidance you are getting. So everything again boils down to, now I'm saying that eating food with lower caste people or whatever, it could be seen as an outward gesture. But I think the inner thing, where who is a candidate for bhakti, and when absolutely no mention is made about that person's caste or community, that I feel is one of the strongest points about keeping things the way ahead, keeping things properly now.
That's true. It's not just in terms of a candidate for bhakti, but even for leadership within a bhakti tradition, there is a lot of openness. If somebody is spiritually dedicated, if somebody is spiritually evolved, then where they have come from in the past is not considered very relevant.
Yes.
And of course, we could say Sankirtan is one way where unity comes in. Different people come and sing and dance together. There is no consciousness of who is from which background. Somebody might be a millionaire, somebody might be a driver, somebody might be a billionaire, something like that. I think the bhakti tradition just offers, as you said, a different worldview. And it basically changes one's conceptions of what is what is to be treasured in a person, and then it gives us a way to transcend these.
So not only there is no discrimination while performing sankirtan, there is no discrimination in giving the benefits of sankirtan. So both ways, those who are performing it, they don't discriminate against each other, and together as a unit, they don't discriminate against who's the beneficiary of that sankirtan.
And this was true even in the past. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he would perform his sankirtan, so probably people would come and they said that hundreds and thousands of people were there, and Mahaprabhu would embrace them and permeate them with love of Krishna. So there is no mention anywhere of anything casteist, isn't it? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said did not touch anyone, because he would embrace anyone and everyone in a sense, although he was a sannyasi. And when they're doing kirtan, they're all coming together. So that caste consciousness is, it's not, it is of course to some extent in the modern day expression of ISKCON, but even in the Gaudiya literature itself, in the ecstasy of sankirtan, that caste consciousness is transcended, isn't it?
Yes, in the temple of Jagannath, while accepting the Lord's Mahaprasad, nobody looks at the other fellow sitting next to him or her. All Varnas, all castes, all communities, they all come and honor Jagannath's Mahaprasad. That is one physical piece of evidence which is even there now.
Oh, beautiful. So then, was untouchability just in some parts of the country, or was it like pervasive? Say somebody is going to the temple and there are thousands of people, somebody at Rath Yatra, obviously you're going to touch people. So untouchability is considered to be like how can you consider somebody so subhuman that you don't want to touch them? That is considered to be anathema in today's by some people. But was it really that widespread?
That's why I suspect that it was made into a plank for denigrating India and everything Indian. That this is how you are. This is how you are. So one could be that there could be a hygiene factor, that somebody is dealing with the carcasses of dead bodies, and in the agricultural economy, there would be a prevalence of so many dead bodies in a particular day or something. So that one particular community which works only with that, they could be considered living in that unhygienic area. So those who are of the higher caste, they would not mingle with them. But as I said, the separation is one thing and animosity or hatred is a different thing. So what the British highlighted,
beautiful differentiation,
that it is the animosity which they made a generic thing, that everywhere everybody hated them. And that's not true.
Yeah, in one sense, in many professions you could have separation. Say if somebody is, nowadays of course computers are very widespread, but I remember 15, 20 years ago, 15 years ago at least, or 20, 25 years, you had to go to a computer lab. You had to take out your shoes and you don't want to get dust particles to get into the computers, or at least you have to be very clean.
Yeah.
So certain professions may require certain parameters for them. But that doesn't, so there could be separation, but that doesn't have to be animosity.
Yeah.
Nirvairaha sarva bhuteshu. So that's Krishna talks about the Varana system, but he also says don't have any animosity towards anyone. So the spirit of inclusion is very much there in the bhakti tradition. And inclusion actually undercuts or destroys the foundation of discrimination. So we could have some kind of division for functional purposes, but at an essential level, at a foundational level, there is an understanding of the oneness of all living beings, of the oneness of the similarity of all living beings.
Yeah.
Okay. So the
summarize, or we have any points?
Yeah. So the Bhagavad, just a quick point, that I think the Bhagavad Gita has several verses which talks about equality. Isn't it? Vidya Vinaya Sampanna is one. not just all human beings, but all living beings are seen to be equal.
Yeah.
So, any thoughts about that?
Well, the one which my favorite is that Tasam Brahma Mahadyogir Aham Bija Pratapita. So, if universal justice means brotherhood of man, which is a, I'm not saying from a feminist point of view, but a old used term, feminist brotherhood of man. Prabhupada says, brotherhood of man can be established only when you establish the fatherhood of Krishna.
Yes.
Establish who is the father, then the brothers will not fight.
That's true. And that consciousness that we may be materially at different levels, but still spiritually we are all together. So that is somebody, the more powerful brother, then they should take care of the less powerful brother. Not that they exploit the powerless brother or something like that. So that's true.
Yeah.
So let me try to summarize. We discussed a lot of things. So we discussed about what caused the caste system to go wrong. One was the incident of Shringi cursing. So basically, one abuse of power by a higher caste member. It was like it started domino effect, and eventually many others started claiming an entitlement mentality. So if somebody claims to be a high court judge because they are born as a son of a high court judge, that doesn't work. And then that created some opposition or resentment. And then, so we discussed about how it started. Then what can be done to fix it? So we talked about, does the system itself lead to social injustice? Well, at one level, across the world, there has been discrimination. And it's almost a feature of human psyche that wherever power comes, some kind of discrimination against the powerless happens. And there was extermination in other parts, but at least in India, there was no extermination. Then we discussed about the resources for reform. It is not that karma and reincarnation, they lead necessarily to perpetuation of social injustice. They can help people who are at a deprived position to gain acceptance of what they are, where they are. And to the converse, those who are wealthy, it can also give them an impetus to give more charity. So then primarily we discuss the resource that the Indian tradition itself offers for social justice is the spiritual wisdom, especially as manifested in the Bhakti tradition. That it shifts the focus of value, not from the body with which you are born, but the kind of heart you are cultivating. And even God is in various manifestations like Jagannath or Udupi Krishna, shows that he values the heart, often inverting the social hierarchy based on caste. And if we overall at an individual level, if we grow spiritually and cultivate that spiritual consciousness, then we can contribute to uprooting this any body-based discrimination that might be there. Any other thoughts on this?
No.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.